After Tuesday's unauthorized fund transfer fiasco on GCash, experts warn of bolder techniques that scammers use to obtain access to bank accounts. Lady Vicentia reports.
Bad actors are getting more creative in finding ways to gain access to bank and e-wallet accounts. Experts also warn reverse social engineering techniques are getting more sophisticated, with scammers using personal data obtained on the internet to convince victims to give up passwords or one-time pins.
Isa sa mga security questions, di ba, kware, what is your mother's maiden name? Di ba, usually pag nag-reset ka ng password, tinatanong yan. Tapos mga kwento tayo online na nababanggit natin yung maiden name ng mother natin. So someone who is trying to reverse engineer information sa'yo, alam na kung gagamitin yung birthday mo as your pin. Kasi these are things that can easily be reverse engineered.
What is really critical here is for our consumers to be able to be aware not to share their one-time pins or one-time passwords or MPINs, no? Because there have been a lot of concerns or cases where practically the consumers themselves are the ones volunteering or providing those OTPs or passwords, no, to individuals, to unknown individuals. So that's why their accounts are being compromised.
Both FinTech Alliance founding chairman Lito Villanueva and financial planner Fitz Villafuerte believe the immediate action taken by GCash to return funds from e-wallet users affected by reported unauthorized cash transfers is evidence safety nets are working, referring specifically to the Financial Consumer Protection Act. The implementing rules and regulations of the Philippine Central Bank state in the event of an unauthorized transaction, the consumer's interests should be protected by the blocking or freezing of the account receiving contested funds. But the action can only commence if the concerned financial institutions are notified quickly. Asia United Bank confirmed some funds were transferred into one of the bank's accounts, and they are cooperating with the ongoing investigation.
We confirmed that there were funds that were transferred to AUB. I'm afraid the relationship of the user is with GCash, so we would extend the cooperation and support that GCash would need, but for good order and good protocol, it would really be the consumers going directly to GCash where their accounts are.
GCash being the owner of the account, everything has to revolve or initiated from them. So sila ho magfa-file. May concern sila whether we need to return the funds. And they have to provide the correct reasons also. May nagkamali lang ba na napunta sa amin, then we will correspondingly act on them.
East West Bank, meanwhile, said it immediately acted on the reports of unauthorized cash transfers and initiated an internal investigation. The bank also said it is cooperating with authorities to resolve the matter. Villafuerte stresses bad actors will continue to operate if nobody is punished for the incident.
Dapat the government is also doing their part in ensuring na, number one, mahirapan or hindi talaga magawa itong mga scammers na to, yung mga techniques nila. And number two, I think very important na napaparusahan yung mga nahuhuli. Kasi syempre kung ang daming regulations, ang daming mga layers of protection, pero hindi ka naman nakaka-reneg ng balita na may naparusahan na scammer, then more people or other scammers can still have parang mamomotivate pa rin sila or malakas pa rin yung loob nila kasi walang napaparusahan.
Consumers are advised to keep a personal record of their transactions and to report anything they find suspicious. Lady Vicentia, ABS-CBN News.
E-wallet service provider GCash denies there was hacking involved in the reported unauthorized fund transfers that affected some of its customers. Several GCash users earlier said money from their accounts were allegedly transferred to accounts in East West Bank and Asia United Bank. GCash did not disclose the total amount affected by the incident, but it says all funds of affected users have already been returned. Citing the result from its initial investigation, GCash said the users unknowingly clicked a phishing link.
Definitely no hacking. Because kung meron tong hacking, the impact could have been bigger, no? We are not blaming our customers. Based on our investigation, that we found out that this impacted customer base unknowingly accessed a phishing link. Ang nakita namin sa investigation, this fraudster, hindi siya nag-action during the time that he was able to phish and mine this information from the customers, no? Again, how did we found out na ganito? There is a request to link a device. Yan yung lumabas na investigation natin. And an OTP was sent. And using those information, the fraudster was able to make that transaction.
An update now on power issues hounding parts of the Philippines. Energy Secretary Rafael Lutilia admits he cannot say for sure if there will be no longer the power interruptions in Luzon. But he says the agency is doing what it can to minimize inconvenience, like requiring the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines to ensure the implementation of its protection systems among generation plants. For Lutilia, the power supply issue can be addressed by fast-tracking and upgrading the transmission systems in parts of Luzon and contracting of ancillary services. He also pushes for the reopening of the Ilihan plant.
We would have had sufficient supply even though the reserves were thin, but this particular tripping of the transmission line was not expected and therefore did not figure in the power demand outlook for May. So for as long as we have the Ilihan power plant, which is 1,200 megawatts, and which has not been been in operation since June of 2022. Then, for as long as it is not back in service, then our reserves will necessarily be limited. So we hope that by June, the Ilihan power plant with its LNG fuel will already be online. Probability, given that we actually have, we will have adequate supply once Ilihan is back in operation, then we have really better chances of having a more stable supply in the zone.
Lutilia is also seeking a performance audit of the NGCP.
I hope that here we are able to start on new ground and that we will be able to do this because we want to be able to ascertain exactly where the weak points in the transmission system are and address them. So as you said, whether it is by NGCP or NGCP working with government or through PPPP, then we can try the other alternatives where needed.
The Philippine Health Department reminds Filipinos the COVID pandemic is not yet over. This is after the World Health Organization lifted the public health emergency status on COVID-19 last week. DOH officer in charge Maria Rosario Vergere asserts, now is not the time to be complacent, especially as the country again sees an uptick in COVID cases.
Kailangan tuloy-tuloy pa rin tayo mapagmatyag. We are vigilant. And kailangan patuloy pa rin tayong aware. Alam natin kung ano ang gagawin natin, kung paano natin mapoproteksyonan ang ating sarili, pati na rin po ang ating mga kamag-anak.
State insurer PhilHealth urges encourages medical practitioners or more medical practitioners to join its so-called consulta program, which provides primary health care services for its members. This as Anak Kalusugan Party List Representative Ray Reyes says there are not enough accredited providers in the country to allegedly due to the lack of interest of these medical facilities to be involved in the program.
It's really more of a reputation of PhilHealth with the relationship on these providers. Something as simple as having a more responsive reimbursement mechanism for whatever expenses that they have incurred in providing these services. Sometimes it's actually more than enough. I believe that we're trying to verify reports that sometimes it takes more than 90 days for some of these medical facilities. If they could reduce it to around 45 days, this is something more manageable already. And this should be able to incentivize some of our medical facilities to join this consultant program.
Philippine Central Bank Monetary Board member Bruce Tolentino clarifies his remark on President Marcos's Kadiwa program. He asserts the program, which sells agricultural products at lower prices, is an important measure amid high inflation. Tolentino hopes the administration will find a way to provide more opportunities for Filipinos through the Kadiwa program. The remark comes after he questioned its viability. He said the program will cost government money since the Agriculture Department will be subsidizing the products. Two Filipino women in Sudan cry for help to be evacuated as fighting in the war-torn country drags on. One of them, Rebecca Mendoza, says she has already applied for repatriation, but her employer refused to let her leave.
Nakita po ng aking amo na ako po ay nagpasa ng detalye dito sa aming lugar. Ipinasa ko po sa Egypt ng embassy yung location namin dito. Nagalit po sa akin ang amo ko. Kasi sabi po niya sa akin, ipapahama ko daw po siya sa ginagawa ko. Nag-away po kami ng amo ko noong isang araw. Pinagbablock niya po yung mga nagkontak sa akin dito.
The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department assures them it will find a way to bring them home.
We can ask yung honorary consulate po natin sa Khartoum na gumawa ng paraan para maibigkas siya. Ang una natin gagawin batas sa batas, kausapin natin yung amo dahil since nasa custody siya ng amo, we don't want to be accused na we are kidnapping itong kababayan natin. Of course, ibang klaseng panahon na ngayon sa Sudan, gagawa ko tayo ng paraan, kakausapin muna natin yung amo. And of course, kung talagang ayaw, then we will make plans for her to be released.
On Tuesday, 55 more Filipinos arrived home to the Philippines, bringing the total number of repatriated Filipinos to 475. 18 more are expected to arrive in the country this morning. Authorities say there are still 40 Filipinos left in Sudan who have refused to leave.